Tribute to Sir William Harris on his 90th birthday, we're broadcasting a recital of his organ music recorded by Nicholas Danby in St. George's Chapel, Windsor. The programme's introduced by Dr. Herbert Howells, who was speaking in his study at the Royal College of Music.
This brief talk of mine will be about Sir William Harris. He's 90 today. But that isn't the sole cause of my speaking of him. And I am not offering him the cold mechanics of official congratulation. Far from it. More simply and more sensibly, I am here in the name and as the voice of countless devotees to greet a most remarkable musician who is still very much in our midst. And I have in mind an imagined miracle. It's just this. That if this present year of grace were in fact 1573, and a mature Harris a real part of it, I think the famous Tudor musicians would be saluting him, birthday or no birthday, because they would know him as a composer of their own kind, enriching, as they themselves were enriching, music dedicated to the service of the church. They would be acknowledging him as an equal member in their own illustrious company. But in fact, we are in 1973. And for his immediate contemporaries wishing to honor him, neither the miracle nor the anniversary is an obligatory condition. We speak of him in his own time and ours. And we want to offer him our tribute. And we do just that in sheer admiration and affection. In that spirit, presently, we will be listening to Mr. Nicholas Danby's recital of a select few of Sir William's organ works. Works that will be a reminder of the composer's own brilliance as an organist. And those works will do even more. They will stress the fact of his unfailing stylistic gifts and may even rebuke some of us who may be inclined to write some more music for a noble instrument and write as if it were a mere substitute for a one-man orchestra. Stylistic propriety has been Sir William's strength in everything he's done. It marks his very lovely motets. His setting, for instance, of Edmund Spenser's Fair as the Heaven is a supreme and flawless example of the ordered beauty of his church works. For my part, I often have him in mind as the complete musician. In his long career, all the factors that govern a vital musician have been present and very finely balanced, as much in the executive as in the creative sphere. There have been five or six chief centers of Sir William's activities. Ask any of them to recall his work for them. Ask Litchfield, for instance, whose people enjoyed nearly 10 years of his working companionship in and about a famous cathedral. Or ask Oxford, and it will recall Balliol concerts, New College Chapel services, the Bach Choir, that is, the Oxford Bach Choir. It will recall Christchurch Cathedral in its perfectionist heyday. All these found in him the man of untroubled ideals and his ability to translate those ideals into practical realization. Or again, if the search is for a man for all occasions, look back to him as he was in St. George's Chapel. Windsor, of course, summed up the man who, at that focal point of high ceremonial, confirmed music's vital part in ceremonial. To the musician of great occasions, we readily turn and do. Even more, we turn to the composer of music for service of the church. Such music as makes so many of us think of him as the sole translated Tudor in our living midst. And now, in his alleged retirement at Petersfield, serenity and undimmed technical alertness go with him, day by day, to his work table. Today, he is as ready as ever to demonstrate that eight-part vocal counterpoint and double choir textures can, under providence and a skilled hand, produce sounds appropriate to the beauty of the cathedrals and churches that are their natural destiny. As often as he puts pen to manuscript, he bluntly, but beautifully, reminds us that the human voice is an instrument as delicate now as it was in the mythical days of the Garden of Eden, and must not suffer abuse.
That tribute to Sir William Harris on his 90th birthday was given by Herbert Howells. Nicholas Danby begins his recital of music by Sir William Harris with the Fantasia on Thomas Campion's tune Babylon Streams, written in 1922. After the Fantasia on a tune by Campion, Nicholas Danby plays the Prelude written by Sir William Harris in the Church of St. Thomas, Leipzig, in 1931. Nicholas Danby continues his recital with the slow movement of Sir William Harris's Organ Sonata in A minor. It was written in 1938 and is marked Adagio Espressivo. This recital of music by Sir William Harris ends with his Flourish for an Occasion, composed in 1948. Flourish for an Occasion ends this recital of music by Sir William Harris, given by Nicholas Danby on the organ of St. George's Chapel, Windsor. The programme was introduced by Herbert Howells.